STARS is dedicated to saving lives through leadership, innovation, and unique partnership. We provide safe, rapid, highly specialized emergency medical transport systems for the critically ill and injured. The Emergency Link Center, or the ELC, is where it all begins. Our role is to work with partners such as EMS, fire, and hospitals to find the critically ill and injured. Listen to this call.
STARS Emergency Link Center, this is Andrea. Who am I speaking with?
Hi there, it's John with BC EMS calling. We're processing a call at the Glacier National Park area. We've got an EMS crew that's responding to a staging area at the Rogers Pass compound, and we've got, looks like, a hiker that fell down a 30-foot cliff near the Falcon Hut.
Okay, any idea of injuries?
Yeah, it looks like we've got a significant head injury. We've dispatched a rescue helicopter, and we'll swing the patient to the staging area, and we're requesting STARS to rendezvous at the staging area.
Okay.
These are the kind of things that we hear every day. And our response doesn't end with a call. We oversee the mission, and we coordinate transport and care. Our aircrafts are constantly being monitored. We secure safe landing zones, work with our partners to coordinate the mission, and do what needs to be done to keep the aircraft and the patient safe. The locations that we respond to are remote, and they can be difficult to access. Our patients are also in life-threatening situations, so we need to be agile and we need to make decisions rapidly. Now, that's just one patient, but as you can see, there are thousands of patients that need our care. Now, let's take you on a behind-the-scenes tour of how we use ArcGIS to make decisions in real time and manage these complex and dynamic emergencies. We received a request about an accident near the town of Lake Louise. A vehicle had rolled over. Two patients were trapped in the vehicle with serious injuries, and a third had been ejected. The location was approximately 10 kilometers southeast on Highway 1. Now, when we receive a request, the information includes a requesting agency, location, and a response type. EMS uses a numbered system to identify a response type, so in this case, we'll select a 29 Delta 2 for a high mechanism motor vehicle collision. Now, EMS is already responding by ground ambulance, but do we also need a STARS response? We use a dynamic set of standard operating procedures to tell our dispatchers precisely what they need to know so they can make that decision. Most of you are familiar with an SOP. It's that big standard operating procedure manual. What we're doing is making that dynamic. Paul will now explain how we automated this process.
In real time, the geography of the incident, dispatcher information, and the helicopter status are all fed into our GeoVent server. This is where the magic happens. GeoVent enriches the information with additional knowledge and filters it down to only what is needed. That model generated this dynamic SOP. It tells us what we need to know when we need to know it. This improves efficiency, reduces human error, and helps us ensure the best life-saving decisions are made.
Now we can answer the question, and STARS is required. So let's go back to the event and dispatch a STARS aircraft. Now, because we assigned a resource, GeoVent has created a new feature which uses the AVL of the helicopter. Using factors such as the status of the aircraft and the base it was dispatched, the SOP is instructing the dispatcher to perform actions such as giving updates to our pilots and our air medical crews. Now let's follow this simulation to see how the dynamic SOPs continue to unfold. Our dynamic SOPs are responsive. In this case, the dispatcher neglected to confirm whether a landing zone had been secured. Because our SOPs can adapt, GeoVent alerts us, and the dispatcher is instructed to secure the missing landing zone. We're proud of this innovation because now we have SOPs that are as dynamic as the events that we manage. Let's switch gears and show you something equally as critical, and that's how we leverage our partnership to support the patient.
One of our strongest partners is the oil and gas industry, like those working out of the Alberta oil sands. There are thousands of workers across Western Canada in remote locations. These workers are in areas with no address, difficult ground access, limited availability to medical resources, and are often in hazardous conditions. Engaging with our partners, we pre-register their emergency response plans and provide them with a unique site registration number. STARS engages these industry partners to record their medical capabilities, which may be the only available care in the area. This kind of collaboration improves access to medical care, and we call this neighbor helping neighbor.
Dynamic SOPs, site registration, neighbor helping neighbor are a few examples of how we use GIS to support the critically ill and injured. In the words of one of our dispatchers, these maps and apps have changed our world. Now I want to share something with you that's really new and exciting for us. Though we've been in the business for 30 years, until recently, we haven't been able to analyze our historical data on a map, such as the millions of points contained within our SkyTrack AVL data. Spatial analysis is helping us make better decisions, and for us, better decisions equals saving lives. For example, we're using GeoAnalytics server to aggregate everywhere we've flown. Using this analysis, we can begin to see patterns. We can clearly see a high number of transports from Grand Prairie to the higher level of care in Edmonton. Here we can see how routinely we're going to certain hospitals or we're going directly to the scene. Looking at the areas west of Calgary, we can see the indirect route that STARS takes to navigate the mountains. Now, this analysis is leading to new questions and new ways for us to answer those questions. For example, this map shows the change to the frequency of STARS transports geographically and the extent of those changes. This is answering the questions, where do we fly, where don't we fly, and how does that change over time? We're starting to see some really interesting patterns in the data, such as the lower flight frequency to areas in Grand Prairie, Western Manitoba, and this area northeast of Edmonton. A lower frequency may indicate fewer patients, and that's a good thing, but we're excited to see what else we find with our analysis. The traditional reference used in the ELC is our chart of call. Decision makers use it to determine the best form of transport. It evaluates the time it takes to get to a patient, how long we're on scene with the patient, and ultimately, how long it takes to get that patient back to the tertiary hospital. Now, we expect that STARS response time to change based on our straight line distance. However, when we compare the linear estimates to the data, the times are different when we go north, south, east, or west. We look at the geography southwest of Calgary, we can see the impact that terrain has on our response time. Now, this highlights an interesting pattern that we had known, but were never able to see. In the mountains, STARS is often unable to take a direct route. We're also dealing with patients located in remote and sometimes difficult to access locations, and that all delays a response. This is no longer a linear problem. So do we need to adjust the chart of call times to reflect this? Earlier, we asked if geography had an impact on our patient package time. Our chart of call estimates that at 30 minutes, and our analysis shows that average to be around 27 minutes. But there are several outliers. Now, we've seen this data before in a table, but putting it on a map gives us a visual that has instantly created chatter amongst our team members. For example, the area between Saskatchewan and Manitoba immediately pops out. We need to dig deeper into these trends. Finally, let's look at our total time to tertiary care. This is one of the most important metrics because it identifies how long it takes to get the patient to the care that they need. Using the geostatistical wizard, we remove the random variations, and it helps us find the average of total time to tertiary care for the region. What we've found is that when we're in a normal operating radius, we've got a good idea of what our total time to tertiary care is. But when we're outside of that radius, we need to consider factors like fuel and terrain to make a more accurate measurement. Combining our linear formulas with geography, we can refine our chart of call to better reflect actual transport times and ultimately make a better transport decision. These are our success stories, our VIPs, our very important patients, When we talk about dynamic SOPs, mapping, spatial analysis, innovation, engagement, what we're really talking about is improving the tools our team uses to help us make more success stories. Because at the end of the day, it's about the patient. Thank you.